I also studied linguistics, as has our speaker for tonight, Laurel Sutton. And I studied as an undergraduate at the Berkeley Department, and she was a graduate student, got her graduate degree there. But the reason I think it's interesting is how many different ways there are to go professionally with linguistics when you're choosing not to be an academic, which our professors, I think, generally thought we were going to follow in their lineage and turn into academics. And look at us here, we're out in the world. So Laurel has been making her way by helping people evaluate and make up wonderful new words or names for products, code names, teams, all kinds of things, companies. And here she is to tell us her story.
Thank you, and it's a delight to be here. I'm going to have some places where we can have some participation during the talk, and so I'm not quite sure how long it'll go. If I'm starting to go over, just let me know. Okay. So I named this talk, Please Stop Naming Things. And I don't want you to stop naming everything, but I think there are places in technology especially where there's too much naming, and I'll tell you why I think that's the case. And you can argue with me if you don't think that's true. So just to tell you who I am, I studied linguistics. I went to graduate school at Berkeley. After I did that, I did not go into academia, and I started a naming company called Catchword, and that's what I've been doing pretty much for the last 20 years. And I'm also an information officer for an actual organization called the American Name Society, which is somewhat academic, but is moving a little more into business naming, the kind of work that I do. My company has created names for Fortune 500 companies as well as Bay Area startups. We've worked in just about every industry that there could possibly be. And naming isn't just being creative, it's dealing with things like trademark, dealing with domain names, naming architectures, figuring out how a company's whole product line is named, and things like linguistic analysis, which is my area of expertise. So often if a company is global, they have a name for a product, they want to make sure it works in every country in the world and it doesn't mean something bad in a language that's not English somewhere in the world. So that's a lot of the work that I do. Just to show you some of our clients, we did not name all of these companies, although we named some of them. We named Asana, some of you might be familiar with them. We named Upwork, you probably know who they are. And for the others, we've done a lot of product naming generally. We named FireEye also. So we've done tech stuff, we've done services, we've done a lot of internal naming for these companies. We were on retainer with Cisco for many, many years and named tons of things for them. We're on retainer with Corning right now, and we name a lot of their tech products and some of their pharma products as well. So I wanted to just introduce you to the terminology of naming. So people think, oh, names. There are different kinds of names, and it's important to know what the distinctions are between them. So this is how we look at it as a naming company. There are descriptive names, and those are real English words that tell you what a thing is or what it happens to do. To give a Cisco example, they make a lot of routers. One of them we called the Integrated Services Router. Good descriptive name. That's what it does. It integrates services. Generally, those aren't trademarked because they're not special or have some ownable quality to them. When we say the brand, excuse me, brand names, we're really talking about what we would call suggestive or arbitrary names. So a suggestive name suggests something about what a company or a product or a service does, and it can do it in real English words, or it can be something that's coined, a made-up word. Things like Catchword, for example, is a suggestive name. It doesn't say exactly what we do, but it suggests something that we do with words and that they're catchy. Catchword is a real word, but we're using it in a different context. Microsoft is a suggestive name. It doesn't say software for microcomputers, but it is Microsoft, and you get the feeling of what they do. Arbitrary names are names that just don't have any connection to what an offering happens to be. And arbitrary names are really fun and interesting, but from a marketing point of view, you really have to explain to your audience what they mean. So Apple's a really good example of that. Apple doesn't have anything to do with computers or music or video or any of the things that Apple does or makes, and it never did, even from the start. There have been many stories about why they are actually called Apple. Steve Jobs told many different stories, and Steve Wozniak told many different stories, and it's not really clear why they chose it, but it was not the education aspect, as is sometimes said. It wasn't that they were making educational computers and they thought, oh, Apple is what you bring to a teacher, or the apple falling on Newton's head. That wasn't really the answer. And arbitrary names can be real English words, like apple. They can be made-up words, like Kodak, for example. Arbitrary names are fun, they're cool, they're easy to market, but they're hard to explain to people. So when Kodak first started, they had a hard time saying, why are we called Kodak? Well, it means film, it means photography. There was a lot of education that had to happen. This is a naming spectrum just to show you how we divide up the world. So this is the science-y part of naming. Descriptive names here that are made up of real words, more suggestive stuff here, more abstract stuff down there, and then they can be real, compound, or coined. We would put Kodak in the coined category. And you can argue over where the boundaries are for some of these things, but generally that's the way it works. So as I go forward in this talk, I'm going to talk about both the very descriptive things, but also some of the more branded things and where they fit in business in general, especially technology. So when we undertake a naming project, we have to be really clear on what a name can do. So what does a name do? What is it meant to do? It identifies what the thing is. So you can have a product like this, but if it doesn't have a name, it's really hard to talk about it. What is it? So let's give it a name. It identifies that product or service or company. It can help your customers remember what that product or service or company is. You know, it's not a thing, it's got some name attached to it. And if you do it correctly, it can really reinforce whatever the brand is. So as a good example, when Apple started going to the small I convention, they were naming everything with that. There was iMac and there were iTunes and iPods. So you knew when you saw a new product come out, if it had a little I in front, it was somehow Apple related. So that really reinforced their brand. But when our clients come to us, sometimes they really feel like, well, our product is pretty crappy, but if we give it a great name, people are going to want to buy it. This is not true. A really good name cannot save a terrible product. And conversely, a name that's not so good isn't going to kill a really good product or service. People will want it anyway. They're not going to not buy it just because of the name. They may not like the name, and maybe it would be more successful if there was a good name attached to it. But a company is not going to go bankrupt just because their name was not great, for example. Names also can't carry every marketing or communications message. So if you have some things about your product or service or company that you want to explain to your client, your customers, you can't squeeze it all into those seven letters of the name. You need to rely on your other marketing aspects and your graphic design and your web copy and your collateral. And a name can't really replace other brand elements, so the look and feel of a product is extremely important. You know, product design, UI design, all of that stuff is related to the name, but the name can't just overrule everything else that you do. Everybody loves to name things. Naming's fun. And when you name a thing, it's no longer a thing. Right? You have a name for it. It's an actual existing thing. If you have software and you give it a name, now it exists. It's real software. People always want to show off their creativity, because naming is really fun. Coming up with names is cool and fun. You can play with language. Everybody loves to play with language. Everybody's really good at coming up with creative things. And when you do give a thing a name, it gives you some feeling of ownership over it. You came up with that name. You decided what that was going to be called. It's why people name their cars. You know, you name your pets, you name your children, some people name their houses, you know, then it's yours once you've given it that name. But when it comes to business type naming, whether they're descriptive names or suggestive names, sometimes people get really carried away. So when do you need to name a thing? There's some really good times when you do, and I'm going to talk about those, and then I'm going to talk about some times when I think naming just is a little excessive. So going back to that brand names versus descriptive names thing, when would you need one of those? Well, in the first case, sometimes you invent something and there is no descriptive name for it. You need to come up with a way to talk about the thing. Sometimes there is a descriptive name, but you want to put a brand on it because you want to own that thing and have that ownership. Sometimes there are many descriptive names for a thing that nobody can really agree on. So maybe in that case you want a brand name to bring some clarity to the situation. And sometimes there are descriptive names and people insist on renaming the thing, in my opinion, for no good reason. And I will show you some examples. So let's look at this one. These are not rollerblades. They're a different brand. Rollerblade is a registered trademark of the company, which is now called Rollerblade. They weren't called that when they started. But when they invented these, the term inline skates did not exist. They came up with the concept. There had been things that were kind of like that, but there wasn't a word for it. So they had a problem when they first started making these types of skates because people didn't have a way to talk about them. They would just call them rollerblades, but that's a brand name, and you don't always want people using your brand name as the generic thing. It's why Xerox doesn't want people saying, make a Xerox. They want you to say, make a copy. And why you don't say, they don't want you to say Kleenex. It's a tissue, it's a facial tissue. So they don't want it to become generic. I just looked up their trademark, and in fact, they're not called inline skates in the trademark application. They're called longitudinally aligned rollers, which is terrible. And later they changed it to inline skates. So that's the descriptive name for this kind of skate. Rollerblade is a brand. Rollerblades came on the market, they were extremely popular, but eventually other companies like this one, whatever they're called, they came on, and now if you are looking for these kinds of skates, you put in Google inline skates, you don't just put rollerblades, and you get many, many, many brands. So now Rollerblade is a brand, and inline skates is the descriptive term for it. And they were very, very fierce in protecting their trademark, and they didn't want people using it all over the place, just like Xerox does, and just like whoever owns Kleenex, I can't remember. So that's a situation where there wasn't a descriptive name and they had to invent one, and they did. Now let's take this object. Does anybody know what a Zune is? Yeah. All the old people are like, yeah, I know what that is. When the iPod was invented, I guess, portable media players existed, and they were called portable media players, and they were called digital media players. There was a descriptive name for this thing. But Apple, because they are a company that relies heavily on their brand, wanted to give it a name. And it was a name that needed to fit in with the things that they already had, like the iMac and iTunes, which launched about 8 months before this. And the name iPod is generally regarded as a great brand name for a lot of reasons. It's really short. It's only four letters. It relates back to the other Apple products that already exist. And it's not a descriptive name, because it doesn't describe anything about this, right? It doesn't say digital, it doesn't say music, it doesn't say player. It says pod. What is a pod? A seed pod, maybe? A thing that you hold in your hand? Something that contains other things? It's very evocative in that way, but it in no way describes what this object is or does. So when the iPod evolved over time, it was fine. They didn't ever need to change the name because whatever they called an iPod was an iPod. There are still lots of digital media players on the market. I listed some of the old ones that were there. I still have a Rio, a little one like that. And the Zune came along, but it was terrible, so no one bought it. It really is a thing that kind of became the category descriptor, but there were still lots of other digital products. So the iPod name was because Apple wanted to own this object in that space. They didn't try to make that the name for all of them. Again, fiercely protecting their trademark so that not everybody would call everything an iPod. And they honestly had the biggest share of the market, right? Because the iPods were so much better than anything else that was out there. So most people actually had iPods and not Zunes or some other thing. Now, here's an example of an object that has a lot of names. And I could think of about five. So I wanted to ask you guys, what do you call this?
Pendrive.
A what drive?
Pendrive.
Okay.
Flash
drive.
Repeater.
So, I'm sorry, it's hard for me to hear up here.
USB stick.
A USB stick, okay. What other things?
Flash drive.
A flash drive, okay.
Thumb drive.
Memory stick, right? The problem is that everybody calls it a different thing. And it's really confusing. And to date, the industry has not settled on a term for what this is. Depending on where you are, what country you are, or who you're talking to, or what region of the country, it's called something different. This is a problem because when you're talking to people who maybe aren't quite as technically as savvy as we all are, you might say, bring your memory stick, and they'll go, what's a memory stick? And then you have to say, flash drive or thumb drive, and then you go through like the six or seven until you get to the one that they actually know. It's like, oh, now I know what you're talking about. So this is a case where too much naming has happened. I don't know which was first. You could probably find out by looking to see what was, you know, the first descriptive name for this thing. But everybody who came after it thought that they had to call it something different. And, ooh, the one that we come up with, flash drive, that's going to be the one that everyone uses. Well, it wasn't. And neither was USB stick, and neither was thumb drive. So everybody calls it a different thing. And it's, I think this is a problem for clear communication in technology. It's so much simpler for consumers if they know what you're talking about, and the name is always consistent. Let's look at something else. Okay, this is an example from a standard kind of Bluetooth headset. So here's the thing that I noticed. So this is a standard Bluetooth headset. It's got buttons and things. Some of them are identified as buttons. So this is the mute voice command button. It's got a volume thing. It doesn't say what that is. It's got a switch right here. Call, answer, end. I can't quite see what that is. Why is there no descriptor at the end of that? What is it? I don't know. Is it a button? Is it a switch? Maybe it's a toggle switch, maybe it's a slider, maybe it's a touchpad. I don't know. This is from their manual. This is not good. This is really bad for people because when you're writing instructions, you have to be very specific about what that thing is that you're talking about. And it's tempting to be creative and say, well, we've already got three buttons on this thing. Let's not call it a button. Let's call it something else. But if you call it something else that it's not, when your consumer is looking at it, they're going to go, there's no button here. Yes?
It's also interesting that the whole thing is about the whole thing is about audio.
And there's nothing that points out where it would hear or speak to you. Right?
So
in fact, I think the thing is voice activated as well.
It is, yeah. But it still has a volume thing. And I'm calling it a thing because it doesn't say what that is. I don't know. Is it a rocker switch? Is it a button? Is it a slider? I don't know. Is it a wheel? Maybe it's a wheel. So this is an example where you're using something extremely descriptive, but yet you're not communicating with your consumer, with your user. I don't think they're doing it deliberately to confuse people, but it certainly is confusing. As someone who has to use this thing, that's really confusing. Okay. Now here's another one. Here's an object that exists in the world. I pulled this image off Amazon. It sits on your desk, and you put your mobile phone into it. And now you can use your mobile phone integrated into this object. And now you've got a handset, so you can pick it up and use it. Let's. What do you think this is called? What would you call this? There are no right answers here. I'm just really curious to know what you guys would call this thing.
I can't even imagine.
A phone dock.
Okay, a phone dock.
A mobile cradle.
A cradle, okay. Fred's got an idea.
A mobile phone desk set.
Desk set, okay, that's interesting. Any other suggestions? Like I said, there's not a right answer here.
It's on the tip of your tongue, no?
Okay. I think I'd call it a charging station.
A charging station, okay. All right, that's cool. In my line of work, we had a client who had something similar to this, and they asked us to come up with another descriptive name for it. We went through all those things that you guys just said. It's a collaboration base. It's a desktop connector. It's a desktop integration base. It's a desktop workstation. It's a mobile phone extender. It's a smartphone station. Something a little more creative. It's a touch base. Ooh, you can touch it like that. But you know what? Why are we coming up with these names? Like, this already has some names. And actually, most people think it's called a docking station. You said phone dock before. When you search on Google for this, it comes up as described as a docking station. And I think for people who are familiar with this kind of technology, that's what it is. It's a docking station. So why do we want to rename it? Well, because docking station, it's so much better than that. It's better than the competitor's docking station, so we have to give it a new name, and thereby confusing all of your customers. Because then you say it's a whatever, a touch base, and your customer goes, what is that? And you have to say, it's a docking station. So anytime you have to give the name and then someone tilts their head like the dog and goes, what is that? And then you have to say what the actual thing is, you've just lost a customer, pretty much. You shouldn't have to explain what the thing is if it's descriptive. Now, you could develop a brand name for this. If you had a really good one that was totally different and maybe it had some whiz-bang kind of features to it, sure, go ahead and develop an iPod-style name for it. But don't reinvent the wheel for something that's already got a perfectly serviceable name, like docking station. So this has been in the news a lot lately. I wanted to give you guys some fun examples of Silicon Valley reinventing things. So Lyft is launching a commuter shuttle service. It's a bus. It's actually a bus. You just invented a bus. Co-living. Roommates. You've invented roommates. Good for you. Gold star. Co-living. Like, come on, really? Co-living? No one's going to use that. And there's already a perfectly good word for it. Do you remember this? This was a couple months ago. These guys were going to put this thing called bodega into buildings. It's a vending machine. And also, using bodega for something like this is not cool because it's totally cultural appropriation and it represents something very, very important in an urban landscape. They were very roundly chastised for trying to do this kind of thing. I don't think they're actually going to do it. The pause pod. It's a tent. And you put it in your office. I know it's kind of hard to see there. You have it in your office and you get inside it during the day so you can get away from your coworkers that you hate. A pause pod. It's a tent. And then this one, this was just the other day, and you can see by the timestamp on it. So it's an interesting concept, what this company is trying to do. They're not venture capitalists, but they're trying to create a community investment fund where people in the community put money into a fund that goes to improving the community, like building roads, or maybe improving the water, or schools. That's taxes. That's what we call taxes. So while you can really approve of some of the efforts involved here, the language is supremely confusing, and people will immediately make fun of it. If you try to do stuff like this, especially on Twitter, you will be savaged for it. So this is where I'm saying, you know, too much naming, guys. You don't really, really need to do that. Okay, now, I think we have some discussion stuff here. So here's the thing that I have noticed personally. I really want to know what you guys think about this. When you look at instructions for your phone, often they will say, find the thing on the phone and tap it, or sometimes double tap. It's used quite frequently in the instructions that I've seen for anything with a touch screen. So tapping is, this is a dictionary definition, it's a little light blow, right? You just tap, like you're tapping your fingers or you're tapping on a windowsill or something. It's not the same as touching, right? Touching is different. Touching is like that, and tapping is like that. It's not the same as pressing, which is a longer contact. Maybe hit, you know, hit that button on your desktop, or, you know, maybe hit, a little violent, more violent, hit. Click, which is a holdover from when you use a mouse, so if there's no touchscreen, you would use a mouse, you would click on something. Or hold down, so tap is like that, hold down is more like that. Not quite the same as press, maybe, a little semantically different. So in my experience, tap is a word that only really exists in kind of user documentation. I don't think I've ever heard a person say to another person, look at your phone and tap on that. No one says tap. It's a little artificial. They will say touch it or press it, but not tap. So I'm very interested in how this word tap is making its way kind of through our tech instructions and UX, and you know, it's an instruction that you give to people, tap this thing. And whether it might actually become part of our spoken vocabulary, right now it seems to be really constrained to written vocabulary. For some people, it doesn't make any sense, so I always give my mom as the example. My mom is 88, and she knows how to use an iPad, and she loves it. If I said to her, tap that on the screen, she would look at me like I was insane. Like, what do you, tap? I don't get it. Like, okay, mom, take your finger and just touch it gently, and that she will understand. So in your experience, do you see the word tap a lot? Do you write the word tap when you're writing instructions? Is that the preferred word? I see some people are nodding generally, yeah, okay. Have you ever said that to anybody? Have you ever told them tap it, or do you ever just write it?
Got a yes back.
So you've said tap to people? Yeah. Yes, please, comments. I want this to be a discussion.
We've reverted him back to a flip phone now, but my dad used to use a touch phone, and we would have to say tap, mm-hmm. not press, not hold,
right.
just tap.
Tap, and did he get tap, like what that
no,
meant? Or did
still,
you have to show him?
He's still, so mm-hmm. we used the instructions, but obviously it did not settle.
Yeah,
okay.
Not successful.
Okay.
So we were introducing a smartphone app to octogenarian, and he kept trying to jam his finger through the phone, and we're going, no, tap it. So tap was the correction.
Right. So did he get what tap meant without you having to actually physically go like this?
I have no idea.
Okay. All right. That's where I'm really interested. It's like, do people get tap if you don't show them what a tap is?
We don't necessarily use it with the users, but internally, when we're talking to designers, a lot of people use tap target to talk about the bounding box around different mm-hmm. things on mobile devices.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I was working with several clients, and these were small startups, primarily the younger founders, and they use tap all the way. And they also, I think, when I was talking to the users, also young college students, they also use tap pretty mm-hmm. frequently.
Okay, it could totally be a generational thing. You know, I'm old, so tap for me is weird.
When we were testing, in some cases, mobile interface, people were actually saying click when
click.
They were tapping. It was interesting to hear that because in our instructions on the UI and when we refer to it, you know, like somebody was mentioning internally as designers, we say tap and we write tap, but the users were like click.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that gets, so it's definitely the holdover from clicking with a mouse, but there's also the reinforcement that in some apps, when you tap it, it actually makes a clicking noise. So you're tapping, but you're getting the click feedback, and so therefore a click is reinforced in your mind.
So I have a wife that has a hard time with interacting with her phone. And I think tap comes from music. It's tapping, which is a dynamic thing.
Mm-hmm.
Dwell time is a big damn deal with touch interfaces.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think it's capturing this idea that it's something that is done in
like
a certain
that,
amount of
right,
time.
Yeah.
It's not a long dwell, it's a short dwell. It's mm-hmm. not a hit, it's a tap.
Right.
So it's softer than you know.
than a hit.
That's what I am.
Yeah, okay, that's so interesting. I was talking with a friend of mine who's a tech writer, and she said because she has to write instructions, not for consumers, but internally at her company, they avoid that word. In fact, they try to avoid all of those words, and they will say things like, look at the menu and select. So they'll just not even address what is the actual physical description of the word that goes there. Select from the menu, not click, not touch, not tap, not any of that stuff. Interesting. Do you think there are any other words that could serve as tap? I mean, tap is kind of the word in English that we have for that, right? That motion. I don't know. I did some synonym exploration. I couldn't find any.
Long ago, I did some research around how two people sort of like could communicate together to get something done. And the distinction between selecting something and a word like tap can often, I think, can be potentially usefully understood as the distinction between like a goal statement versus an execution statement.
Yeah, an action word, right?
Something that one might say is on one side of the gulf of execution or the other.
I haven't looked at this internationally. Do any of you happen to know how that word gets localized? Is it tap in other languages? Anybody know? This is going to be a good linguistics paper, I'm now sensing. Okay, I think it would be fascinating to look and see how it gets translated. Every language has a word that means that, that tapping type of movement, but it would be neat to see if they describe the thing that you're trying to get them to do with that same word, or whether they have some other word that, that describes it. And in fact, whether they might be almost onomatopoeic, right? Like the way click is now. Sort of tap is a little bit like that too, I think. Okay. So this is what I'm, this is how we think about these things, linguists. We're like, ooh, tap. What is the semantic field for tap and how does it work? Okay, thank you all for your input. That was really, really interesting and helpful. Okay, so let's keep talking about naming. So you're at your job and you're doing stuff and you're thinking, should I name this thing? Well, here's some questions you could ask yourself. So let's go back to that, that docking station example. Does it already have a name in English, a good descriptive name? You know, if it does, maybe use that rather than trying to come up with something new and funky, especially if it's essentially that thing. You know, maybe it's a docking station that has some additional capability, like, I don't know, it's got like special Wi-Fi on it. But really, if it's a docking station, you don't need to rename it and call it, you know, a, an ultra set for your desk or something. So think carefully about whether the existing name for a product or a service or part of the UI, if you can use the name that already exists. If you really think you can't, why not? Is it because there's some capability that you need to highlight that's really important for the user to know? Perhaps is there some ego involved in wanting to rename that thing? You know, a little glory reflected on you? That might not be such a good reason to rename a thing. If you do need a new name for it, can you use something that's really descriptive? Can you make a new descriptive name out of existing English words rather than trying to come up with a brand name for it? That's usually the best course of action if you can find a good descriptive name. Sometimes it takes some tries, and you might not hit on it exactly right the first time, and you can never really be assured that your descriptive name for a product or a service or a category will be the one that the industry adopts. Lots of clients come to me asking. They say, oh, we want to come up with a new category descriptor for this thing. Well, we can try, but it's not up to you whether that becomes the category descriptor. You can't make that happen. It's whether people want to adopt it, if it's a good technology, or if the name is good for it. But you can't tell the world, this is the new category descriptor and you must use my name, because they just won't do it. If you really, really want a brand name for something, it's not sitting at the bar after work and scribbling things down on a napkin. It maybe was like that in the 50s, it's not like that anymore. If you really, really want a brand name, you need money, you need time, and you need a lot of patience to develop something that's going to be good. And you really need to know how trademarks work. So this is a really huge deal that most people don't know about, but it's the reason why people hire my company, because there are hundreds of thousands of trademarks in the US alone, and globally it's like in the millions, especially in technology. If somebody out there is already using the name that you came up with for something that's very, very similar to yours, you can't use it because they will probably sue you, and their lawyers will send you a cease and desist letter and say, I'm sorry, we're already using this trademarked name, you cannot do it. We've had many clients come to us after they got that cease and desist letter in a panic, going, oh my God, CES is in 3 months and we need to launch this thing and we got this letter and we're gonna go bankrupt and you need to come up with a new name for it right now. That's happened many times. So knowledge of the fact that trademarks exist and you have to abide by trademark law is really important. So I wanna talk in a minute about code names and how that all works. Just to give you a little taste of what I do, when a client comes to us and they want a name for a new product, you know, a thing, have a very strict process that we always follow. And we have found over 20 years that if we try to subvert the process by making things a little shorter or omitting a step, it will end in disaster. So we always meet with the client, we do a background materials review, we call that an immersion phase. We like to learn as much about the thing that we're trying to name as is humanly possible. We have a briefing meeting and we talk with them. We find those briefing meetings are often like family therapy, because everybody's in a room and they're talking about their cool product, and often it's the first time that they've been in a room together talking about why this thing is so great. And so we get to hear a lot of conflicting opinions and, you know, oh, where should we go with the name? And then we do our creative work. So we always write a brief, a product brief, just like you guys would do for any kind of project that you have. And it's very detailed, and it says, here are the messages that we're gonna explore. You know, it needs to say fast, the name needs to say global, or whatever the messages happen to be. And here are the specifications. So it needs to be 6 letters. It needs to start with the letter A, because all the other products start with A. It needs to sound feminine, so maybe it ends in an A or something. And then we do creative. So for us, our creative is huge. Typically on any given project, our creative team will do, I don't know, 1,500 names, 2,000 names, a lot of names. We don't have software that generates names. This is people sitting at computers with reference books. We do have tons of books in our office, but also looking across the internet and finding whatever kind of resources we can to come up with synonyms and metaphors and semantic fields and words from languages other than English. We will take a subset of that. No client wants to see 1,500 names. So we will take maybe 40 or 50 that we think are really spot on and show them to the client and say, is this what you're looking for? Sometimes they'll go, yep, there's 10 on here that are really, really good. Sometimes they'll say, well, there's 4 that we like. Could you do more in this direction over here? So then we'll do our round 2 creative. And then before we present the final group of names to the client, we do a trademark search. So we look in the publicly available database to find if anybody is using any names that are the same as the ones we're suggesting. Because if we show names to a client and they can't actually use them, then it's pointless. What have they paid us for? So we try to do some pre-screening on the names. Their lawyers have to do a full legal screen at the end, which is quite lengthy and pretty expensive for them. It's like, I don't know, $5,000 per name to do a global trademark screening. So you don't want to do too many of those, but you need to do some pre-screening. So when you're developing names, you cannot come up with a great name and go, that's it, let's go and use it, let's put it on that product, because you haven't checked to see if you can actually use it. And because so many names are out there in the marketplace, the chances are very, very high that if you do an internal naming exercise and you pull a name off that first 20 that you came up with, you can't use any of those 20 names because other people are already using them. And honestly, that's why people hire companies like mine, because we go and we look under every rock and over every hill and up in the sky to find things that aren't being used. So the one thing that I would really ask of you all as creative people who are working in development is, whatever name you have, be consistent how you use it. If it's a button, always call it a button. Don't call it a button on one page and call it a switch over here and call it a slider over there, because it's confusing. And you have to make sure it's consistent over every single piece that you have. So manuals, web copy, training manuals, things that are internal, things that are external, you have to be consistent about it. And it can get down to these very fine things, like take a name like Viewpoint. Is it a cap V, P in the middle of it? You know, that makes a difference. That actually makes a big difference. What is the name? Is it Viewpoint with a cap P or not? Is there an E at the end of it or not? You need to decide, and you need to be consistent about it. Your legal team will want you to enforce these things very, very strictly, and it can actually make a difference with the legal availability of a name, whether you're using it correctly. I'm working with a new client right now, and in fact, Viewpoint is one of their names, and they have it spelled 3 different ways on their website. That's really bad. So for a customer, is it the same? I don't know. Maybe it's a different product that's got a cap P and doesn't have a cap P. You want to be clear and consistent. To reiterate what I've been saying all along, really resist the urge to rename things with new versions or when you have revs or something. If you don't need to come up with a new name, don't. Put a number after it, you know? there are ways that you can keep using a name without having to rename a thing every time. And finally, I said I would talk about code names. When you have a new name for a product or a service, leave that code name behind, right? Don't keep using both of them. Don't keep using the code name internally and the new name just for external purposes, because they're going to collide like this. And then the Titanic sinks and everybody is very unhappy. So here's some advice about code names. When you come up with a code name, it goes right back to that slide I put at the beginning. Why do we come up with fun code names? Because we want to own this thing. We want to be cool. We want to like have it be ours. I came up with this great name. That's true, but on the other hand, trademark. You probably can't use that name to go public with it. You can use it internally, but you can't use it externally. The longer you use a code name internally, the more attached you become to it. The more it starts to leak. It can get slipped into a press release. It can be in the code. It can be at a trade show. And once it gets out, you're kind of screwed, because people now think that is the name, just like, you know, Revolution. If you call it Revolution internally and you keep doing it and it makes it out there, people are going to think that's the name of your product. And you can't use Revolution. People have used it already. You need to pick something new. So there's a certain amount of inertia as well. If you've been calling something Revolution for a year, changing it to something new is very difficult, because all of your emotional energy is invested in this name that you've been living with for a year. So sometimes we go so far as to hold a, seriously, like a mock funeral for the code name when we're developing a new name, so that people can kind of get over it and go, yes, I grieve for you, old name, but here's the new name, it's so much better. So what we've suggested to clients when they're doing code names or project names is pick things that will never make it to market. And here are some examples. So use farm animal names. You know, you're never gonna go to market with something that's called chicken or pig. Use names of cheeses. You're never going to go to market with this thing being called, you know, Panier or provolone or something. Fish. Name it after fish, you know, tilapia. Or other things that just aren't going to make it to market. People always want to use cool code names. Planets, Greek gods, mountains, streams, things that are close to you. And those are kind of cool. They're fun. But you're not going to be able to transition that to an outside name. Legal is going to stop you. And then you're going to have to really say goodbye. If you choose something that's kind of unappealing in the first place, it will be a lot easier to say goodbye to it when you have to actually let it go. So those are my suggestions. I'm sure you could come up with many, many more, from categories of food or, you know, bugs or whatever. It's really useful, and a lot of companies that I've worked with have done this, is that the brand marketing team actually has a list. So they've got, you know, 100 names, and when somebody has a new project, they go to brand marketing and say, what are we going to call it? And they go down the list and they say, COD, that's your name. And they don't get a choice in it, but you have to when you work for, you know, a really large company with projects that are going on all the time. Let's see, so I want to just put in a little plug for two things that have been really helpful for me, and I'm not sure if any of you are linguists or have had some experience, but the linguistics as a academic thing has reached the same point that many other social sciences had, which is that there aren't a lot of jobs in academia. So I and people like Nancy and Suzanne have been working really hard to take people from academia and move them outside into cool jobs, like the kind of jobs that you guys have or I have. So there's a group within the Linguistic Society of America, which is the big organization, called Linguistics Beyond Academia, and the SIG stands for Special Interest Group. So it promotes careers, and there's networking, and there's some mentoring. We have a cool Facebook group. We meet once a year at the LSA meeting. And then on a more personal and smaller level, one of my friends, Dr. Anna Trester, has this thing called Career Linguist, which is really neat. It's a community that does some of the same stuff, but it's much smaller. I think there are about 50 people that belong to it right now. And there's a real collaborative space to it for people who are looking for careers or who are just interested in linguistics and kind of want to pursue that as part, you know, as like a parallel track to what they're doing. And she wrote a book called Bringing Linguistics to Work, which is really good. So for me as a linguist, finding this career naming has been tremendous. You know, I was really burnt out in graduate school, and I didn't know what I wanted to do. I didn't know that naming existed as a thing, and then I found it, and it was fantastic. And so I really wanted to work to inform people about the importance of linguistics and what we as linguists can contribute to the world at large, the world that you guys live in every day, mm-hmm. and how important clear communication is, and that's what linguistics is about. It's communicating clearly and studying and understanding language. So that is what I have tried to do today in this little talk, and I hope you guys have found it useful. So thank you very much for letting me come and talk.
And we'll open it up to more questions, and I'm going to start with a comment, because I think it's relevant, and I hereby offer you the opportunity to use it. Some friends of friends named their in utero child Freddy the Freeloader after the comic book character. And
that's a deep cut.
they got so enamored of the name. I mean, they were so used to calling this prospective baby Freddy the Freeloader that when he came out, they ended up naming him Fred, which was not the name they had planned on.
What's wrong with that?
It's a great name, but it wasn't the name they planned on. Fred will now respond.
I have some free baby naming news. If
we called our daughter Spike before she was born.
Yes.
I have a comment also. I'm a retired technical writer, and I dealt a lot with what I call terminology, which is the naming things within a product. I worked in enterprise software, and the administration interface had 500 concepts, and so we use the rule: every concept has its own name, and two concepts don't have the same name. So, do you make this distinction between naming and terminology? I think that in Canada there's actually a job title called terminologist.
Oh, really? That's interesting. I would put it under descriptive naming. You know, you're coming up with real descriptors, real English words. It can be multi-words, right? It's not just one word. It can be three or four words sometimes. And we've done that. It's hard. It's way harder than people think it is. You know, they're like, oh, descriptive names, it's just English. Anybody can do that. Like, no. It's very hard.
Typically what I would do is I would develop a number of possibilities and make a recommendation and include my excluded, the names I considered and didn't recommend and why I didn't recommend them. And that kept people from coming back to me and saying, what about?
The what about. That's the way to do it.
What about click?
Give somebody else a chance, Les.
So there's also a dark side to code names. If you pick the wrong code name or get stuck with something that's not quite right, you actually have to spend more time managing up to keep your project from being canceled. So my first code name was Spin. I thought it was nice, Spin. So spatial interface was descriptive and all that. And so S-P-I-N, and I capital S, capital I. And the CEO took a look at it and said, looks like spleen. So do you have a suggestion for for that side of things?
That's a really good point, and it's very, very tough when you're dealing with opinions at the C level, because they're often, people who are very confident and very impulsive in their reactions to things like that. You know, the business side, they're not impulsive, but on the marketing side, they tend to think like, yep, I know exactly what's going on. And in naming, it's the same. I mean, we have the same problem when we're developing it. If I had a nickel for every time the VP of marketing says the CEO will sign off on whatever I recommend, I would be very, very rich at this point. So sometimes it's good when you're dealing with people like that to have several options. Say, I've come up with five. Which one do you like? Have them pick it, and then you're good. So options are good to have in that particular situation. That's like political maneuvering that you sometimes have to do.
Thank you for your talk. This has been fascinating.
Oh, thank you.
So you had you sort of mentioned somewhere naming teams, right? And you want to do something like that for morale for various reasons. And then I saw your slide about code names and things like that, and my brain went, I wouldn't call my team pig or sheep, maybe tiger or something, right? Something that gives you that boost. So do you have any do's or don'ts when it comes to naming? I mean, and also even probably with projects, right? You want to have something that people can feel inspired about. But so do you find a disconnect between, sort of giving it a name that's doesn't mean anything, and that something that's inspirational and that gets them more motivated?
for us, the difference would be, say, a team name, for example. That's never going to be public, right? You're never going to put it on a product. You know, it might be in the news if you guys did something for charity and you raised a lot of money. So you can name your teams whatever you want. And they should be inspirational, you know, maybe play on something that everybody has in common or whatever. So team names, you know, go ahead and name them what you want. Project names, it depends, right? If it's ever going to be something that could go to market, you really can't choose something that could go to market. You know, you're not going to name it Revolution, even though that might be the thing that gets everybody excited, because the pain at the end when you have to change it is going to be really intense. So maybe you can do two things. You name the project, but then you name the team. So your team name is something really fun and cool, and the actual project name is whatever provolone that you have up there. But I've worked with so many people at different levels in a company, and having worked with so many lawyers who really get angry when that happens, when the team comes to them and says, we've been calling it Revolution for a year, and we already put it on a press release that went out yesterday. And they're like, no, damage control. Then you got to take that back. You got to say, that's not the name. So you never want to be that person, right? Because you don't want to lose your job or something. So there are just real world constraints that you have to work in, and you have to weigh it against the team building that you need to do.
Hi. Your answer might be that it's proprietary, but I'm curious where we can learn more about the process to name something correctly, and then, or you know, maybe the process that you kind of showed in your bubble slide there. And then also, do you have any tips for when you've hit success, as in you found the name? Is it like the light bulb goes off and everyone goes, oh, aha, or is it not always as, like, you know, a relieving activity sometimes?
I'll do part two first, and the answer is never. That never happens. Because if it did happen, it's because you recognize that name and it's already in use. So it's the familiarity of it. You see it and you go, oh, that's really cool. And your subconscious is like, yes, I've already seen that on a very similar project. So yes, if you ever have the blinding light bulb moment, you will not legally be able to use that name. I can guarantee you that will happen. In almost every naming project that we've ever done, it's been a slow process where we presented a bunch of names, client kind of thought it over, we presented another round of names, and there were three or four in the top three or four that were always being considered. And at some point, one of those kind of rose to the top for lots of different reasons. And the cool thing is that once the name is chosen, people can never remember what the other ones were. It happens. The name becomes a brand. As soon as you do a logo and you do some graphic design and you put it on a bezel, that's the name. And then it's the name. And now it's not just a word anymore, it's actually the name of the thing. And that's true for, you know, I was thinking of Asana, right? And that name, I think, is one of, I'm most proud of that name because it's such a perfect fit for the company, and it was such a journey to get to that point. And it suits them so incredibly well. As far as how to do naming, if you go to the website for my company, catchwordbranding.com, we have a naming guide that you can download. It's a PDF, and it kind of takes you step by step through the process and how to make lists and stuff like that, and that is freely available to all. Oh, I also have some little books here that have some of that same information if you want it. This is a naming guide written like a car instruction manual, which is kind of fun. And it's got a little analysis of car names in the back if you're into that kind of stuff.
So I have two things. One was actually trying to follow up on your question in the last discussion about globalization and you know what happens when you have to like name things. And I noticed in the app that I use frequently, Duolingo, I had asked my in-laws, who don't speak English very well, to use it in their native language. Mm-hmm. And the language was so formal, even they were like, what are you talking about? Right? When you say press this, they use the word press, but in like Hindi, it's not press. It's something really strange. Yeah.
What does it mean? I really want to know
you
now.
When the bow, it can be like press gently or like touch gently. Uh-huh. It's like not one word, but uh-huh. It's actually a kind of like a phrase.
You have to describe it.
You have to describe it, and I say press, and they get it.
Okay, interesting.
So when I hit the terms and conditions, it showed me terms and conditions in English. It was strange. And then secondly, one thing that we're going through right now is in the product that I work on, they initially named something incorrectly, caused a lot of confusion, and now we're thinking maybe we should rename it to the correct thing based on like what we've heard on feedback and what's the terminology that our users use and also what our competitors use. But I don't know if you have any like suggestions on what might be different things we could do to make a good argument.
Just let me say, she works for a company that's well funded, so you might want to have this conversation later.
Oh, that's fine. You know, renaming is hard. It's really hard because people get used to it. If you do it, it has to be a project, and somebody has to be in charge of the project, and that person has to be the bad cop. And really, like, you have to make a huge list of every place that term appears and make sure that it gets changed in every single place. It's very boring, but you have to do it. We have something like that. We actually have a kit that we give to our clients, like when they change the company name, here are all the places that you need to change it. And it's astonishing how many companies don't do that. We've worked with Cisco, when they acquire companies like, you know, they're eating candy, and sometimes it would go on for a while, and we'd be like, you acquired these guys a year ago, and they're still using their old email addresses. Like, no, gotta go away. You know, it's hard, change is hard, but if you want to support a brand, that's what you need to do.
So I really like that story you just gave, and we all have stories about naming. I had a product I was trying to get accepted, and people that were supposed to accept it called it Castaway. Mm-hmm. Because they didn't want to accept it. but I'm sure...
very so.
I would be fascinated. I bet you have more stories about such things than anybody. And it'd be really fun for whatever you can remember. Or you probably have some stories you used to help sell the naming process. Just some naming experiences would be...
I got a million of them. I can tell you the Asana story, because that is, as I said, it's one of the names that I love the most that we've created, and it's a cool story. So those guys, Justin and Dustin, from Facebook, multimillionaires, they're very, very, very nice guys. I like them a lot. And they had just left, and they had, you know, dump trucks full of money, and they said, we're going to start this new company and do this thing. And they were calling it Project Luna at the time. I think that was just a code name for it. And they are very, and I use this word very carefully, they're very spiritual guys. And their spirituality and their view of the company as a place where people want to work and can derive self-worth out of putting stuff into it is extremely important to that company. I don't know if you know anybody who works there, but there's a huge emphasis on life-work balance and really, you know, finding satisfaction in what you do. So we would go to their apartment and talk about this, you know, hours spent just kind of them telling us their philosophy and throwing around words and thinking we made lists of things that they were really interested in, you know, like vegetarian, love to travel, like to go to the woods, like to do yoga, like cats. And we really tried to make the name work with their personalities. That doesn't always happen, but because it was just the two of them, there was nobody else in the company. They wanted it to reflect something about them. So we kind of triangulated on the yoga thing because they feel yoga is really important. It still is. And so we went through many, many words associated with yoga. Now, an asana, which is the way you're supposed to say it, is a yoga pose. And asana in yoga means not just a passive pose, right? Like you're not just, you know, you're ready. You're in a pose, the pose has strength, it has weighting, but it also has energy. And they felt like that is what we want our company to represent. It's something that's full of energy, but it's not aggressive, it's not punching people. It's something where you are ready to do the next thing, and that's what the Asana software helps you to do. It helps you manage, it helps you get ready. So they love that. When we got to it, it wasn't their first choice. There were like five or six that we went through a number of times, and I can't remember what they are now. But eventually they liked it, and so we started looking at it. Well, it's a beautiful word. We knew people were not going to say asana. They were going to say asana, but that's okay. If you look at it visually, it's all on one line. There's no ascenders or descenders, so it's really pretty looking as a word. It's very easy to pronounce in languages other than English, because it's consonant vowel, consonant vowel, consonant vowel, and it has all those A's in it, which makes it sound really open and expansive, and you say it, and it sort of fills you with this, like, airiness. And the more we talked about it, the more we began discovering all these good things about the name. So it took a long time. That project was probably, I don't know, 5 or 6 months before they finally got to the name after these many layers of discussions and legal checks and all the rest of it. We had to negotiate to get the domain because somebody owned it, so they had to spend some money to buy it. But it turned out to be the perfect name for them. So that was one of the best experiences that I've had. And I love that name, and I think it's a great name for their company.
So there's a stage where you've done the secondary presentations, and then you've done a preliminary check. Then it ultimately comes back to the company, and they have to do the exhaustive check. Do you have a story or just even a mitigation plan as a company? Like, what happens if it comes through that exhaustive check and the name that they had selected turns out to be out there? Is it, well, let's just try the other options we have written down?
That is what we recommend. So our goal is always to keep a pool of names in contention. It's never the one name. So as we go through a huge funnel, right, like 2,000 names, get it down to here, and we always say to them, you should be sending like 8 to 10 names to your lawyers. We know it's $5,000 a pop, but it's worth it. So that way, if they check 8 names, and even half of them fall out, there's still 4 left, and they can look through them. And sometimes names fall out for the craziest reasons, often for domain reasons. So I can think of 2 fun stories that I will share with you now. One was quite a long time ago, and it was a guy who owned the domain, and he lived in New York, and he insisted that he be paid in cash for the domain, and it was quite a lot of money. I think it was $8,000 that he wanted in a little paper bag in cash. So he arranged to meet the lawyer for the company at like a coffee shop in Brooklyn, and the lawyer brought the contract, and he brought the little bag of money, and they sat down, and they signed it, and they had a laptop, and they did the transfer, and it was done with a little sandwich bag with $8,000 in it. So that happens. And then much more recently, for another client, they had the names. They had made it through legal. I think there were 3 choices. But the name that they wanted, the domain was owned by a guy who has a Christian-themed marriage counseling service, and he would not sell it. And this is a multi-billion-dollar company. And for love nor money, he would not sell this domain because he was very deeply religious, and he felt like God had given him this name for his service. I mean, he's probably right, I don't know. But he wouldn't sell it, not for any circumstances, and we offered to create a new name for him. We said, you know, dude, we'll come up with something better. Nope, he would not do it, and he still owns it, so they had to go with another choice, which turned out to be a good choice for them anyway. But you just never know what's going to happen when you get to that end of it, especially with domains. It's wacky.
How often with your clients you go through the process of finding a name that works well in the English language? Is there ever situations where it needs to work well in multiple languages?
Mm-hmm. That's often the case. I mean, almost every name is global now, right? If you have a website, somebody's going to see it. For clients like Corning and Cisco and Keysight and others that have offices all around the world, we do a lot of linguistic checking to make sure that the name is going to work, that it's pronounceable, that it doesn't mean something really bad, and that there isn't some existing brand or cultural or political association with it in that country. So we do the same thing when we do link checks. We'll check 10 names, and maybe the checking will eliminate 2 of them for really serious reasons. And then they've still got some to choose from. But it's really important to do it. I will let you all know that the story about the Chevy Nova, has everybody heard that story? It's an urban legend. It never happened. So the story is that Chevy had a car called Nova. They have Novas again now, right? They're making them now, I think, because they resurrected a lot of their old car models. And the urban legend is that they were never able to sell it in Mexico or any of the Spanish-speaking countries because Nova literally is Nova in Spanish, which means doesn't go. But that's not, I mean, it's not true, really. If you speak Spanish, you would never say Nova. to describe a car, like no go. It's not correct Spanish. And also, Nova is a word in Spanish, you know? The biggest oil company in Venezuela is called Nova, and it has been since, you know, the mid-50s. So it's a great story. It's very interesting that it became this urban legend that people repeated, and if it was true, that I find far more interesting than the story itself. And you hear people saying it all the time, but it's absolutely not true. They did market the car in South America and in Mexico, and it sold just fine there. They never had a problem with it.
I have two questions related to the software naming. The first one being, you know, you might have a head brand name, and then sub features have their own specific names, but I guess, can you go too far and have too many specialized names and not enough descriptive names, and is there a right balance, and how do you think about that? And my second question. We'll start with that one.
Sure. What we like to say to our clients is that when you're trying to come up with, say, branded names, like we talked about what a branded name might be like, perhaps for a feature or a technology, it's okay as long as you're not overdoing it, so you're not naming every feature with these funky names. Pick the one where you kind of get most bang for your buck. You know, if you've got something really, really special, some feature that nobody else has, maybe it does deserve a branded name, especially if it's a feature that you can implement across different platforms, and then that's kind of a through line. It's like Intel Inside, right? It goes in different things. So maybe you can justify the cost and the time to come up with a good feature name. If it's something that's only going to have a shelf life of a couple of years, probably not worth it. It's very expensive to do it. But there is a place for it.
And the second quick question is around software. A lot of the things you're naming are kind of metaphors for things that exist in the real world, which, mm-hmm. you know, if something looks like a post-it note in the software, mm-hmm. kind of going back to the tap thing, how do you think about calling it that when there's no real correct name to call something like that?
The great example is Windows, right? That's what it is. It looks like a window, and it looks like a desktop, and you put things on your desktop. I think it was, from a linguistic point of view, it was kind of a stroke of genius to correlate what's on your computer screen to what you would normally see in an environment, because people understand that. It's like a super simple way of getting people to understand what you're trying to get them to imagine in the space that doesn't exist. So as long as it accurately reflects that and you can use it, I think it's good to do that. And sometimes, you know, if you try to take it too far, it might not work very well, or people won't understand the correlation. And for some people, you know, my mom doesn't really get what a desktop is. She's like, well, it's sitting on my desk. Like, no, that's not what I mean. It's here in the computer. See how it looks like a desktop? That looks like a folder. And that looks like a file, a physical file. That's pretty good. People know what those things are. So in that respect, it's good. I find it really interesting that so many things from the analog world carry over. So when you use Skype and you go to the keypad, it looks like a keypad on a phone. That's because everybody knows what a keypad looks like. They don't have to do it that way. They could do it any way they wanted to. They could go back and make it like a rotary dial, but they've chosen the thing that people are most familiar with from a design standpoint, because you don't have to teach people how to use it. So that should always be your goal. You don't have to teach people how to do things. Give them what they know already.
I think it's very interesting that you said that, because my question was about, what do you think about websites like Dribbble, which basically uses basketball terminology in context to a website which lets you upload design stuff and UX stuff. For me, it was not very intuitive when I went to that website. Like, I did not even know what it was about. And when I opened it up and I thought it's beautiful, but it's using all sorts of sports terminology.
Yeah, that seems kind of limiting. What if you don't know anything about basketball?
Yeah, it didn't make sense to me.
Yeah.
That
one. So partly it depends on your target audience. If you were making an app for people who were really into sports, for example, maybe that would be perfect for them because they would really enjoy and understand that metaphor. But if you're going for a much wider audience, you need to make sure your terminology is actually going to work for everybody and not just a little slice. That seems just like, for me, I would say that's a little too specialized.
Right, and yeah, it was so confusing for me earlier, but now I've gotten it. Like, uploading pictures is called uploading shots in that. So it's kind of confusing, but now I've gotten used to it.
Yeah, but you had to learn it. It still took you time to learn it, right?
Yeah, yeah. But it's cool now because now I can pretend that I know more than the other person. So that's helpful. Mm-hmm. My second question is about what do you think about websites like Yahoo or websites like Skype, for example, which do not have any descriptive words. It's just a brand that they created. Even like Facebook or Twitter, you tweet stuff. Mm-hmm. That's not normally how you say stuff. And they still have become global brands despite having not so descriptive names. Mm-hmm. What do you think about those companies, Pam?
So the reason that their brands are so recognized the world over is because they poured billions of dollars into it. So this is a thing, and I hate to say it because this is my industry, but any name can be a global brand if you put enough money behind it, honestly. I mean, Yahoo is a really interesting thing. So they back engineered it, right, to be yet another hierarchical organizational oracle or something. I can't quite remember what they said it with. It wasn't that. I mean, they didn't choose it for that. They just chose it because it was a fun word. But if you look at the etymology of Yahoo, it's quite a negative thing, right? If you go back to Gulliver's Travels, the Yahoos were the idiots. They were the stupid, crude people. So it's also perhaps in American culture a little bit stereotypical. You know, Yahoos are uneducated people. You know, there's a slight Western thing, which they exploited in the ads for it. But because it was essentially an empty vessel, they were able to build whatever brand they wanted to about it. Putting that exclamation point at the end was a huge issue for them because nobody used it, and it is proper to use it with the exclamation point, but it gets lost all the time. So that was bad branding right there. With Twitter, I actually think Twitter is a great name for what they do. You know, the ethics of the company aside, it's a really good name. So Twitter is a real word. It's what birds do, and it's what has been used to describe what people do. It's sort of an old-fashioned word, like a Victorian word almost, but people twittering, like little bursts of talk. That's exactly what that is, you know? It used to have, when it had the character limit, and they made it very friendly with the little blue bird. And so it was a word that had some meaning associated with it, but again, they put loads of money behind it so that people would understand what it stood for. It has that suggestion of communication, so it's not completely an empty vessel in the way that Yahoo was. So on that continuum, you know, descriptive over here and completely arbitrary, it's kind of in the middle, maybe a little bit more towards arbitrary, but it still has some meaning to it. And it's kind of fun. It's a fun word to say. And then they put tweet with it, which is really great, you know, that it feels so positive and uplifting. You're saying something fun. You're communicating in this almost musical way, which I think worked really well.
I have something that's kind of commenting, but maybe you'll respond, and then a question, and I think I'll say them both. Also, delightful talk.
Oh, thank you.
So I go into a lot of tech companies, and this is something you won't get paid for, but I see a lot of variability in conference room naming, and speaking of limiting, and I think that's a place where companies can really do something lovely in terms of company identity, like if you're calling something COD, and you're sad about that. But there are also ways that it can show a company culture that's a little off the rails in terms of inclusion. So that was the comment. I don't know if you have anything you want to say about that.
I completely agree, and I've been to so many companies where they had delightful names for their conference rooms that it was either natural features, there was one that named them after movies that everybody loved, and that everybody got to vote on what the conference room names would be. So it can be a real team building thing where people get to choose the conference room names. So yeah, like the team names, the conference room names is a place where people can really show their creativity. You can call them anything you want to.
The question is a little linguistic-y.
I can do that.
Yeah. So I once found me through a weird set of circumstances, and I did one naming project once, never again. And it was for, this is how it gets so weird, like a new chemical that was invented by a Midwestern company, and they hired a middle person who found me and a colleague, right? Through, I think, AAAL or something. So I'm not even a member. And so it was so odd. And so the first thing we did was try to look for arbitrary names that denoted sort of technical or science in some way. And they were all taken. Like everything that was like KE or XE or had something sort of technical feeling. So I'm just wondering how you dealt with that. Like, literally everything was, well, I think we ended up going to Greek mythology for this chemical. So I don't know, just if you have anything to say about that.
It makes me cry. It's really hard, especially when you come up with things, names that you think are really cool, and then you're like, oh, I can't have it. So it's just a constant, you have to expect heartbreak as the namer, as the person developing it. And that's why our names are 2,000 long, because you have to check a lot of names to find something that's actually going to be available. I will clarify something about trademark. So trademark law works by having different classes of goods and services. So you can have names that are the same as long as people are never going to confuse the two things. So you can have a car called an Explorer, and you can have an internet browser called Explorer. Nobody is ever going to think that those two things are connected or that they come from the same company. So you can have things that are the names of breakfast cereal and things that are the names of software. That's fine. What you can't have is software and software, or car and car, because then people are going to get confused. And then that's, you know, that's US. And then if you go global, it's times 10 trying to find things that are available. It's just really difficult, and sometimes it's, I have to put my paralegal hat on and kind of negotiate these very narrow waterways to say, oh, could we squeak in with that trademark? Maybe we could. Are they going to get sued? I hope not. You know, it's quite difficult. So I'm sure you've all noticed that a lot of tech companies have totally meaningless names. They're just alphabet soup, and that's because they needed the domain, and they needed probably to get a trademark as well. And for companies that want to get bought by Google in a year, it doesn't matter what they're called. It honestly matters not. Like, if that's your goal, if you're starting your new startup and you want to get bought in a year, don't hire my company. Just make something up. It doesn't matter. You want to have a good name if you have a thing that's going to last, and you want to build a brand on that, and you want to make something out of it. But that's why people hire naming companies, because it's too hard to find it. You're a VP of marketing or you're a product manager, you don't have time to do this. It's a huge investment. Outsource it.
So before I give Ted the mic for the last comment, and then I'm sure people who want to talk to you will come
I'll
up and
here.
Talk. I'm going to make my geeky linguistic comment about tap and click. And if you notice, they both start and end with obstruents. And so I think that's why they're both acceptable. They've got that sharp start and sharp end.
Yep.
Stopped. And stopped with a vowel in the middle.
Click is a little more onomatopoeic, right? It really, kind of, I mean, to me, maybe that's just me. Tap, what does it sound like when you, I mean.
Anyway.
Yeah. That's a really good observation. Thank you for that. I agree.
I would have thought of it already, but good. I'm glad I was here.
Ted.
And I'm glad you're here, too. you know, you said something about CVCs. And I've been thinking a lot about making up words that are easy to remember. Can you say something about what makes words easy to remember?
That's really hard. so I think the memorability comes from uniqueness. So if it's something that you haven't encountered before, and I would put asana in that category. I mean, you know, not everybody does yoga, and not everybody knows what an asana is. So that was an unusual word for people. If it has some kind of emotional resonance, that's helpful too. Now, that doesn't have to come from meaning. It can come from the sound or the flow or just whatever kind of musicality comes out of saying it. That can really aid in memorability. The biggest single factor in memorability is money. It really is. It's advertisements and seeing it over and over again, you know, on your screen if it's you're logging into something and there's the name.
Multiple impressions.
It's repetition. It's pure repetition that makes it stick in your head, even if it's a shitty name. I mean, it'll stick the more you see it.
Well, let's all say thank you very much to Laurel Sutton for sharing her ideas about not naming.
Questions. That was fantastic. Like, great discussion and so many interesting points.
And we'll see you here next month for Luke W., who's going to talk to us about all the wonderful things he's been doing as a creative director at Google.
And so we would make some decision about what we were going to use. And then we'd say, You suppose we can get marketing to use the same language, and then we laugh uproariously. So have you had that?
We try. Yeah, I mean, we really try to get everybody on the same page. And I love style guides, you know, and we're pretty, like, yes, please take them. You know, when we say, you guys should have a style guide, make sure everybody gets it. Put it on the internet and make sure people read it.
Yeah, ours was...
At some companies...
I implemented a style